Just welcome. Oh, welcome to New Hope. If you are visiting here, then welcome. Please put out a card in front of you. We will not hurt actually because of it. But we'll just send you something in the mail that gives you an idea of what we do here at New Hope beyond Sunday morning. So welcome if you're a guest. We've got a few announcements today. The first one is that it's May. Big announcement, it's May. But what does May mean? It means the pastor feed. And we love the pastor feed around here. So it's the event where you get to bring pasta, and then you get to buy tickets to eat your pasta. But you might win something in the process in the raffle. So that's the upside, apart from just feeling that you're supporting fifth and sixth grade kids going to camp. So the pasta feed is about fifth and sixth grade camp. The camp is at Heartland every year, and it's a really good camp. Heartland does an excellent job. This year they have the Mr. J Band, which they've had in the last 2 years. And that's a worship group and a group that teach the kids, and they really, really connect with the kids. It's amazing to watch. So they'll be there again this year, which is particularly exciting. But before that, the 22nd of May will be the pasta feed. And as usual, we need volunteers to cook pasta, and we'll be selling tickets for it next week in the pavilion. So I'm just going to pass a clipboard around for those that would like to participate in providing the pasta, or it could be pizza if you really want, but maybe Italian food, we'll go with that. But it's a really good event, and it's exciting. So like I say, we'll be selling tickets for that next week in the pavilion. If you have kids that are in fifth, sixth grade that want to go to camp, or if you know kids outside the church that want to go to a camp that don't necessarily get the opportunity to do that, then just invite them along. Tell them that we will sign them up. They can go to camp. We have some great counselors, so they will have a great time doing that. And every year, kids from New Hope give their life to Jesus at this camp, and it's well worth them going if they can. Tonight, it's exciting. Tonight we have a Mexico mission night. We have a taco truck, so there's tacos. So there's pasta on the 22nd, tacos tonight, and you learn about the Mexico mission trip. You can watch a video, you can see pictures, you can listen to the testimonies of people that were there. Over 60 people from New Hope went to Mexico on the mission trip. So if you can come to that tonight, that will be excellent. You can really see how their lives were transformed. Transformed was the message or the theme of the Mexico mission. And that's at 5:30 for the food, and I think at 6 o'clock it starts in the sanctuary. Next week, May 5th, National Prayer Day. There's a picture of a flyer in your bulletin that has different places where you can go to National Prayer Day. There's one in Clovis at noon. I will be there representing New Hope. So if you want to come to that, that's at noon in Clovis. There's also one in the morning in Fresno and in the evening at Cornerstone Church downtown. But National Day of Prayer. If you can't make any of those things, really just think about the fact it's National Day of Prayer and take some time to pray for our nation, pray for our city, and pray for the officials that keep everything going in our nation. So Mother's Day is May the 8th, next Sunday. We have orchids for sale out there, $9, and the proceeds for that go to Right to Life. So if you would like to buy your mother or just a special woman in your life an orchid, then do that in the pavilion next Sunday. Prime timers. The prime time luncheon. It's hard. I've had senior luncheon in my head so much I can't think about prime time. Prime time luncheon is not this Monday, but the following Monday on the 10th of May. Tuesday, 10th of May. Thank you. They did not correct me in the 8 o'clock. They were probably asleep. Cowboy Jack Hanna will be there. That'll be an exciting time. I may even pretend I'm 55 and go to that just to see Cowboy Jack Hanna. So he's a man of many hats, apparently. Also on May the 22nd, other than the pasta feed, there is Baptism Sunday. So if you're interested in being baptized, then write it on a card, give it, put it in the offering bag, or just let the office know and they'll put you on the list. We already have quite a few being baptized, which is awesome. So from every age, 8 upwards. So if you would like to participate in that, let us know so that we can get you on the list before that date. The Tuesday night men's Bible study wrapped up. Gene wrapped that up on Tuesday. That will now break for a little bit. We'll pick it up in June. We'll have three Tuesday nights in June, and then we'll break for the summer until September. But just to let you know, it is not coming up this Tuesday. That is now going to break until June. Watch for dates in the bulletin what that relate to that. We had 30 women go to the women's retreat recently, and I think they're wearing dark blue T-shirts today. So if you're wearing one of those T-shirts, please stand up so people can see that you went to the retreat. And they had a great time at the retreat. So if you're interested in going to a retreat in the future, those are the ones you need to speak to, because they had a great time and they will tell you what an awesome experience it is and how it really impacts their faith. So just hunt them down later today. We have some prayer requests. Arlene Bropes, some of you will know her. She's in the 8 o'clock service. She's been undergoing chemo for cancer. She was admitted to the hospital last Saturday. She spent the week in hospital. Her blood pressure was very, very low at the end of the week. But yesterday, I checked in at lunchtime. I had an update this morning. But so it's a little bit higher now, so she's doing a little bit better than she was at the end of the week. But the chemo really is just too much for her at her age. It's just taking its toll. So they have some, obviously, decisions to make there. But keep praying for Arlene and the people around her that are supporting her. We have a praise and a prayer item. So Jordan Falsgraf, Tim told last week about one of our youth, Jordan, who has a mass on one of her ribs. Is this working? Okay. Has a mass on one of her ribs. It turns out the mass is benign, which is excellent news. So the prayers work. The other side of it is she still has a mass, which needs to be removed. So they will need to do surgery for that. So they don't have a date yet. Should find out Tuesday what the date for that is. So keep praying for her on that side. I think the doctor has now said that they're going to keep her out of school till the end of the school year. She is in pain. So just really keep her in your prayers and her family who are walking through her with this. We're going to pray for the family of Billy Adams, or Aunt Toot, as Tim refers to her. Her funeral was last week here at New Hope, so just keep that family in your prayers, as well as the family of Carl Goom. His memorial was yesterday here at New Hope. They don't attend, but certainly we should keep their family in our prayers. And then Jack Williams, very, very close friend of the Roland family, and especially Tim. He died on Friday morning. So keep them in your prayers, that family, but also the Roland family. And, you know, Tim is on vacation this week in Mexico. Not the mission side of Mexico, but the vacation side of Mexico. You know, I think Tim's having a tough time with that. I think, honestly, they're processing the death of Jack. And I think it's probably a good time for him to be on vacation right now. But please keep him in your prayers. It really has affected him quite a lot. Something I'm going to do before we take our offering is I'm going to talk about an initiative that we're rolling out in the church right now, which is called Love Our Neighbors. And I spoke to the small group leaders about this recently, but I wanted to talk to everybody here about it in case it didn't trickle through the small groups, or just if you're not in a small group and haven't heard about it. So I want to talk about that. And again, we'll be following up with this as time goes on. I think we did cover this a little bit last year or the year before. I can't remember, but we talked a little bit about the Love Our Neighbors idea. It's basically low-pressure evangelism, but it has high-impact results. But it also takes a lot of patience and time. I think as Christians, we have three major mission fields. The first one is common community. So the people in our communities that we are around all the time, we spend a lot of time in our neighborhoods, so we spend a lot of time around people that we don't necessarily know very well. But this is common community. That's our mission field. Common family. Immediate and extended family is our mission field also. But then there's common interest, workplace, school, kids' activities, the kids' schools, wherever you happen to be, where you're around a group of people who share an interest. I know some of you are saying my workplace is really not my interest, but it fits into this category, so we put it there. Matthew 22:39 says, love your neighbor as yourself. Ministry begins at home, and we've said this before, the mission field is not just in Africa, it's not just in Asia, it is in the surroundings that you're in, because we share a lot of time and space with people that a lot of us don't even know, and it's an opportunity for us to build authentic relationships with people that we have something in common with. It's interesting to ask how many people, and you don't have to say this, but I could tell you I was one, how many people do not know the names of the 8 closest people to them, to their house. So if you put your house in the middle and you have 8 houses around you, how many people really know the names of the 8 people or families in those homes around the closest ones? I think a long time ago, people would have said, yeah, absolutely, I know the names of these people. Why wouldn't I? They're my neighbors. But now, I think I could come up with 2 when we first started looking at this. And that's terrible. I don't know who lives around me. I don't know who my kids are playing in front of their houses and stuff. I don't know who they are. So I think it's a good opportunity to get to know them through this Love Our Neighbor initiative. We live in a time of fear and mistrust. People move into the neighborhood. Well, we don't know them. Who are they? Well, go find out. You know, don't just hide in our houses. How many times we drive down the street, open the garage door with the garage door opener, drive into our garage, shut it again, get in the house. We don't even touch the pavement outside our house at all. And everybody does this. So everyone's hiding in their houses, locked away. And this is not true of every neighborhood, but it's true of many. So what we need to be doing is taking a conspiracy of kindness to our neighborhoods. Quite a conspiracy. Let's go serve our neighbors, love our neighbors, pray for them. There's a book that I'm going to be using through this process called Neighborhoods Initiative and the Love of God. And these will be on sale next week out in the pavilion if you're interested. They cost $5 or nothing, if whatever price suits you. It's not 10, 5 or nothing this time because they're only $6. So if you want to pay 10, if you want to pay 10, feel free. But at least $5 or nothing is fine. But it's a very good book, and it's written about by somebody who really put together this neighborhood. And it sounds really obvious. Why wouldn't I go know my neighbors, love my neighbors, pray for my neighbors? Well, it's not as obvious as you would think. He describes this as, when love and care thrive in a neighborhood, transformation of a community and the people within it is inevitable. And he tells a story of Mike and Mary Day, and I just want to read this story. And I think as we start doing this, I'll be interested to hear people's stories about how they connected with neighbors so that we can share them and encourage other people to do the same thing. But Mike and Mary Day were a couple from the Writers Church, and they're a perfect example of those expressing this kind of love. They have a profound impact in their neighborhood, especially since embracing the concept of the Neighborhood Initiative. One neighbor said to Mike, I've lived in this neighborhood for 33 years, and I've met more neighbors in the last 2 months than I have in all my years I've lived here. Mike has initiated a number of things to encourage community. He has a prolific year-round garden on the side of his driveway, and the vegetables are ready to harvest. He takes the ripe produce up and down the streets to share with his neighbors. His garden has become a center of attention for neighbors walking by and a means of developing friendships. Mike and Mary recently threw a free car wash and barbecued hot dogs at their home, and those in the neighborhood and those driving by stopped for that. Many of their neighbors dropped by just to talk and hang out. After the first car wash, our neighbor across the street volunteered to host the next one. Other neighbors asked if they too could host a car wash. Car washes are an excellent way to involve neighborhood children that are often isolated. These car washes have led to community dinners, barbecues, and neighborhood garage sale and block parties. And I know some people are already doing this, and that's great. That's exactly what we should be doing. But what we should be doing is being intentional about what we're doing. Take some time, maybe block off some time. In this age of Fitbit, we can walk around our neighborhoods. Just walk around, pray. Pray for our neighbors. If you see people outside, stop and chat with them. Don't just wave. Go and chat with them. See how they are, if they need anything. Serve them if there's a possibility. You'll be surprised sometimes that some people just want to talk. That you stop and chat with them, and as you chat with them, stuff comes out, and you realize that they do need help, and it might be something that you can help them with. And establish your home as a home of light. Be the neighbor that is always there out and about, always happy to see people, and always willing to serve and give where necessary. Schedule time for it, but establish boundaries. Some of the neighborhoods, I'm lucky I live in a 45-house neighborhood, but some of these neighborhoods are huge, so get a map if you have to, draw a circle around it. So I'm going to focus on this area, but be intentional about it. Spend time outside, and I'm going to say this again later, spend time outside. If you're in your house, you're not going to meet anybody, and certainly not going to help your neighbors that way. But get to know your neighbors and meet the needs of your neighbors. Have events, and this book has a long list of things that you could do in your neighborhood if you're interested in doing that. You could start a small group. I know we're big on small groups here, but start a small group in your neighborhood. It doesn't have to be Christian-based. It could be just a small group of people with common interests. A reading group, you know, book club, that kind of thing. Service can come in a lot of ways. Cut lawns for people that have trouble getting out and cutting their lawn. Help paint a house or a fence. Help with fixing sprinklers. That's how I got to know one of my neighbors. In my first house, my sprinkler broke. Well, I'm British. We don't have sprinklers. We have rain. So I didn't know how to fix it. So the guy across the street, I think, was probably watching me for a little while and figured, this guy needs some help. So he came and helped me, and that's how I got to know him. Just turns out he was a pastor as well. Doing a neighborhood car wash, the hot dogs, coffee thing. But prayer walks. Walk around, pray for your neighbors. And ask if you could pray for them or with them. You'd be surprised. When you have that kind of faith, God responds to it. If you go to people and they're having a problem, you say, can I pray with you? It seems kind of bold for a lot of people. But you'd be surprised how many people would say, yes, I would like that. So anyway, that is love our neighbors. We're going to put a map together on a board. So next week I'll be out there with a map. If you are interested in participating in this, and I don't mean you have to commit and do, you know, you have to give me a schedule and everything of what you've been doing, but if you are willing to commit to doing this and taking up this challenge of loving your neighbors, getting to know the 8 closest people to you, you know, within a short period of time, then put a pin in the map. Put a pin in, you don't have to put it right where your house is, because if you don't want people to know where you live, put it in the middle of your neighborhood just to say, this neighborhood is where I am serving God. This is my mission field. And it's not like elementary school, you know, where everybody is pretty much around the school, so all the neighborhoods are going to be very similar. It'll be interesting. They'll be spread out around the place. So there'll be lots of different neighborhoods that we as a church can touch and we as a church can affect. Perhaps fractured neighborhoods, fractured communities in a fractured city that we can pull together with the love of God. So put a pin in it, and then we have a group of pastors that meet every other month about this particular initiative. And we can compare maps. We can say, wow, look, we're covering so much of the city between the churches that are participating in this, and there might be overlap. There might be some neighborhoods that are just going to be so rich with this, and it's going to really, really serve to help those neighborhoods. So I'll be out there next week. You can chat with me about it. I'll be selling the books, and also we'll have a map that you could put a pin in if you want to serve your community with the love of God. Okay, I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward for this morning's tithes and offerings. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this day, this beautiful day, and we're grateful for your creation that we live in, and we love you for that. Lord, we just want to pray this morning for Arlene as she rests in hospital, and we just pray that she continues to recover and she continues to improve, and we just pray for her, not just her, but the family around her that supports her. We pray for Jack Williams' family. We pray for the Roland family as they deal with this, and particularly Tim. We give thanks for Jordan's prognosis, and we just pray that she'll continue to be strong and find love through you and support through you, as well as her family, as she finds out when she's going to have surgery. And we just pray for that when that occurs. And we just pray for all the others that are not mentioned here today but are in the hearts of those here and close to those here. We pray for the neighbors of those here. We just pray that we'll be open and available to our own neighbors in our neighborhoods. And we just thank you for giving us the neighborhoods, the safety of these neighborhoods, that we can go out and we can share your love with others without the possibility of persecution. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, we're going to continue through the book of Psalms. Just because Tim's not here doesn't mean we're going to go off track. I have strict instructions. Psalm 46 is what we're going to be looking at today. Excuse me. Psalm 46. So December 7th, 1941. Does anyone tell me what's significant about that date?
Pearl Harbor.
Right. The attack on Pearl Harbor just lasted 2 hours, but left in its wake 20 destroyed or largely crippled American naval vessels, 300 destroyed airplanes, 2,000 people dead, and another 1,000 injured. A surprise attack that shook America to its core and left people wondering, how could this happen on U.S. soil? President Franklin D. Roosevelt the next day said, "Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a day which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by the naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan." You can bet that the families held each other a little bit closer on that day, the day the country went to war with Japan. But let's fast forward, September 11th, 2001, I'm not even going to ask what's significant about that date. Two airplanes crashed deliberately into the World Trade Center and a third into the Pentagon. And then a fourth crashed in a field in Pennsylvania, its evil plan ruined by other brave passengers on board. Most of us here know exactly what we were doing when the World Trade Centers came down, the Trade Center towers came down. I was in my office with a television that I'd hunted around for, and I was watching the horror unfold with my staff. But we all knew where we would rather have been. We wanted to be at home. We wanted to be with the people that we love. We wanted to be in a sanctuary, a safe place, and not in any danger of further attacks, because the fact is, we didn't know what was going to happen next. There was no certainty on that day. Nothing seemed safe. No one knew to what extent these attacks were going to stretch to. And a tourist, M.J. Shipley of Townsville, Australia, wrote on that day, "I was holidaying in New York on September the 11th. We were sleeping in as our body clocks were stood on L.A. time. We woke to a terrible bang and saw what looked like a smoking chimney on TV, well, at least until I put my glasses on. We sat on the bed and in amazement and watched the TV in shock. The second huge bang occurred when the second tower was hit. It was scary as the F-15 started circling overhead and the panic set in while the town went into shutdown. I'd never felt so far from home." We were unable to call Australia for hours as all the lines were blocked, and we were required to go to the Australian embassy to report, as were all Australians. This was a long, long wait, and the air could have been cut with a knife as people were so afraid and so far away from home. I want to focus on two phrases that he uses in this narrative. First, he said that he's never felt so far away from home. And the other is, people were so afraid and far away from home. Home is our comfort. Well, it is for the most part. When we feel threatened, scared, or uncomfortable, we want to be at home. And when we're kids, we know that when we get home, this is our safe place. And before I continue, I know that that's not always the case, and that home is not always a safe and comforting area to go to. But whatever your refuge is, that's what I want to focus on today. It could be your home, it could be your office, your man cave, your sewing room, your treehouse, or even just your bed. Actually, I saw a balloon floating overhead this morning, a hot air balloon, when I arrived at church this morning, and it was, you can't help but stand and watch a hot air balloon because it's just kind of mesmerizing. That's a tranquil refuge, away from it all, can't be touched. Has anyone been in a hot air balloon? I don't like things without engines, so kind of like horses, I'm not big on anything. I know it's not popular to say that in Clovis, but. Well, the bottom line is we need somewhere to retreat to when we feel threatened. Here's a true story. A retired couple were alarmed by the threat of nuclear war. So they undertook a serious study of all the uninhabited parts of the world. Their goal was to determine where in the world would be the place least likely to be affected by a war, a place of ultimate security. They studied and traveled, and they traveled and studied, and then finally they found a place, an island. On Christmas, they sent their pastor a card from their new home in the Falkland Islands. However, in 1982, their so-called paradise was soon turned into a war zone by Britain and Argentina. There's an expression, home is where the heart is, which basically means your home will be wherever you feel the deepest affection, no matter where it is. What is that place that you have fond memories of? Where is that place that you think of when someone says, go to your happy place? As kids, we've been told to think about somewhere happy, think about somewhere nice, when we're worrying about having bad dreams. But these are all physical places that we're talking about. Today, I want to look at Psalm 46. So let's read through Psalm 46. It's not a very long one, but it's a powerful one. God is our refuge and strength, our ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. The first line, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. And while we think of our personal refuge in times of stress or fear or uncertainty, God is there as a refuge. There are times when we might feel like the weight of the world is on us, pushing us down, the pressure mounting, that all our worlds are about to be crushed. When that happens, all we could think about is going home and crawling into bed. But we should let that weight push us down onto our knees, and push us into the presence of God. We need to slip from fear into prayer, from anxiety into calm, from stress to quiet contemplation about the power of the Lord. It isn't escaping or running away. It actually fits in well with what we've been studying this year, the less, more lifestyle. Less fear, more prayer. Less anxiety, more calm. Less stress, more quiet contemplation. But we're not retreating. We're readying ourselves for action with renewed strength. As it says in verse 1, an ever-present help in trouble. What could be more comforting than this? When things come crashing down, when trouble finds us, as it inevitably will, we don't have to find our happy place, our happy physical place. We can humble ourselves before God and ask for strength. Ask Him to be our sanctuary. The important thing to remember in this is that we will have trouble in our lives. We will have valleys that David talks about in Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. He doesn't say, if I walk through the darkest valley. He says, even though I do. Because the fact is that stress and fear and trouble will strike the godly just as much as it does the ungodly. Christians are not immune to trouble. I want to be clear on this because there's some false teachers that will claim that since Jesus has promised to answer a prayer of faith, that all that stands between you and material prosperity or your health is your lack of faith. It's simply not true, and it's not written in the Bible. Yes, we pray in faith. Yes, God is our rock in times of trouble, and we're not exempted from trouble. But Paul writes of his troubles in 2 Corinthians 11 when he says, five times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. I have labored and toiled and often gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concerns for all the churches. This reiterates 2 Timothy 3:12, where it's written, everyone who wants to live in a godly life with Jesus Christ will be persecuted. We heard about this in secret church on Friday. The persecuted Christians in India, we prayed for them and those others in persecution in countries where the simple act of reading a Bible can result in death or separation from those that you love. Not only does the Bible say that those who are godly are not immune to the valleys in life, but on top of that, it says that we will be persecuted. Is this an encouraging message for you today? Might not sound terribly encouraging, especially if you haven't been to church very much. But the fact is, you will find trouble. Trouble will find you through persecution. But that's not the end of it, and that's the hope. It's not the end. There is more to it than that. God won't leave us hanging. He won't abandon us when trouble comes. And in fact, he will be the refuge in these times. And how do we know this? Because the Bible is clear on it. David is clear about it when he says that God is our refuge and our ever-present help in trouble. Ever-present. Not when it suits him, not when things are still manageable, but always. But this is just verse one, a single verse that reminds us of the all-encompassing power joined together with the protecting hand of Almighty God. It's not a long psalm, but it packs quite a punch. And as we move on to verse 2 and 3, David here starts to list some of the frightening scenarios. The earth giving way to the mountains and then falling into the ocean, storms and earthquakes, the raging of nature. There's a story in the book, The Life of Reverend John Wesley, who was an 18th century British Anglican minister and theologian. And it's written, February the 8th, 1750, there was an earthquake in London. I actually didn't know they had earthquakes in London. That was new to me. This morning, Mr. Wesley remarks, March 8th, a quarter after five, we had another shock of an earthquake, far more violent than that of February the 8th. I was just repeating my text when it shook the foundry so violently that we all expected it to fall on our heads. A great cry followed from the women and children, and I suspect some of the men as well, but it's not very PC to say that in 1750. And I immediately cried out, therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved and the hills be carried into the midst of the ocean, for the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. That's Psalm 46, verses 2 and 7. He went immediately there, in the midst of an earthquake. But it's also I like the description that he gave of the earthquake in the next paragraph. He said, the earth moved westwards, then east, then westward again. It seems a very non-violent statement about an earthquake, perhaps classic British understatement. But here in this area of California, we joke about the big one, the big earthquake. And when it happens, the foothills become beachfront property. Well, this earthquake in this psalm is way beyond that because the whole mountains were swallowed by the sea, no beachfront property there. Verse 4 starts with a more tranquil picture, a river, not a tumultuous ocean, streams of living water, a perennial fountain of God's grace stemming from the throne of God. When he refers to God being within her in verse 5, David is talking about the church, God's church. She will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. The passage then moves to from a sometimes violent side of the natural world to the raging of nations. Nations fought very frequently throughout the Old Testament and beyond. And these clashes were very violent and many lives were lost. But think about the city of Jerusalem, which has known more devastation than most cities between the wars and the earthquakes. In fact, between 587 BC and 1978, AD, that's 2,565 years, Jerusalem has been conquered more than 20 times, by other nations. So the raging of nations against Jerusalem has been a very real thing. And the common way that an army would start attacking another city is that they would start a siege. They would stop anyone coming in and out of the city, and they would just wait for the food supplies or the water supply to dry out. So the critical part of a city under siege was the access to water. Now, Jerusalem was one of the few bigger cities that was actually not built on a river. It relied on a spring called the Spring of Gihon, which was just outside the walls of the city. Well, in a siege, you can see that's not a terribly practical place to have your water source. It's on the outside of the walls, which is where the army that's putting you under siege is. So it was King Hezekiah who had a great idea to build an underground tunnel, which brought the water 1,777 feet from outside the wall under the city of Jerusalem through the rock. And frankly, that feat still amazes engineers to this day. But this is a true illustration of how she, the church, won't fall. God won't allow it. And the streams that flow under the ground of Jerusalem act like rivers that run from God that provide us with the living water. Verse 7 reinforces that God is with us, especially when we need a barrier from trouble. Here it describes God as a fortress, which is repeated again in the final verse, verse 11. These days we rely on banks and insurance companies and our plans for the future as a way to stave off trouble. And that's great. In the Bible it says you should be prudent and plan for the future. But while we do these things, we must also trust in God. He isn't just an insurance policy, but how can we get this incredible trust in God who will be our fortress? What do we have to do to gain this security, to gain this peace of mind that David talks about in the Psalm? Well, we need to get to know God. We need to invite God into our lives and find out who he is. Who he is revealed in his word. And I know it comes back to the same thing, and many of you are like, oh, okay, I know, we need to read the Bible. But the fact is, if I'm going to go fly a plane that I've never flown before, I don't just get in and fly. I may know conceptually how to fly that plane, but there are things I need to know very specific to flying that aircraft as opposed to other aircraft. This knowledge may make my trip much more successful and increase my chances of reaching my destination safely. So I'll pull out the pilot's operating handbook and look at important things that I need to know, like what speed I need to be at before I take off. I need to know where all the things are in this plane as opposed to another plane, all the systems, I need to know how they work. More importantly, I need to know how much runway I need to take off and how much runway I need to land. This is particularly important if there's buildings, forests, or anything at the end of the runway, pretty much anything other than grass, field. So I find out about this plane. I get to know it well so that I can fly it well. Probably without, I could do it without the knowledge, but just as we live our lives without the Bible, what would it look like? It might not be pretty. Everything will be based on guesswork and trial and error. Our lives will find valleys, and if we want to, we can navigate them on our own. We can pull through, and we'll get to the other side, but what's it going to look like? When we take it all on ourselves, the stress, the pressure, the tough decisions, what does that do to us, and how do we feel when we're in the middle of it? Or more importantly, how do we feel when we get out the other side of it? It's exhausting and debilitating in some circumstances. There's a story that Billy Graham likes to tell often when he talks about trusting God, even when we can't see what's ahead. When we're talking about refuge, but not entirely trusting in him. There was a man who became shipwrecked on a deserted island years ago, and he managed to build himself a hut to live in and also store all the possessions that he'd managed to salvage from his shipwreck. He would watch every day for a sign of a ship or an airplane passing by, and he prayed to God for help. Some days he'd get discouraged and wonder if he'd ever get off the island, but he continued to pray. One day he's on the other end of the island, and he noticed some smoke coming from the direction of his hut. So he ran as fast as he could back to the hut. And when he got there, he realized his worst fears had come true. His hut and all its belongings were destroyed by fire, and all that was left was the smoke and rubble of it all. He asked God, why did this have to happen? He didn't understand, but soon he would find out. Later that day, a ship appeared on the horizon and soon landed on the island and rescued him. They told him that they were plotting a distinct course, and they noticed smoke off in the distance, and they thought that the smoke was a signal for help. It was a sign for much-needed help, and it was a sign from God that he was still in control at this time of trouble, this valley, and that he would not forsake his beloved child, even if there was doubt or not. This was the ever-present side of God, the ever-present side that David talks about in the psalm. The doubt, the frustration at this crisis that this man was having was taking his focus away from the ever-present nature of God. And the fact that he is our refuge and he is our fortress. So we've established that God is there for us during our moments of crisis, maybe not as drastic as mountains sliding off into the middle of the oceans or marauding armies overtaking our neighborhoods. But there for us in times when we feel vulnerable, threatened, or afraid. There for us when we face death of a loved one, or we hear news of bad health, or there for us when the money runs out and there doesn't seem to be any solution to it. Knowing this is one thing, but how do we live like we know this? How do we release the stress that we feel daily about the mounting problems in our lives and put on a joyful smile, it's like spring, a joyful smile that either makes people feel like we're completely insane, or hopefully more in this case, they see a joyful life, despite the problems. Because we have a faith. We have a faith in Jesus. We have a comfort that can only be explained through the lens of the Bible. So let's look at some ways we can apply this knowledge. Six ways that we can place our complete faith in God when the odds are against it and when the valley that we are in is long and dark. So number one, this is a simple one, but it deserves to be repeated over and over again, is pray. There is nothing like a crisis to bring us to our knees in prayer. So yes, we pray when things go wrong. On September the 11th, 2001, you can bet that God found more people praying on that day in this country than any day since. But once that day was over, how many were praying then? Who were the prayer warriors that kept praying without ceasing? It's not a job that we have to do. It's not a chore. Praying is our personal connection to God. This is how we communicate with him. So talk to God. He wants to hear from you. Not just when the realization hits that things have gone horribly wrong, but constantly. Even after everything has passed, even after we've walked out of the valley, pray with an open ear. Listen. Don't just talk. God will open your eyes and heart to a new understanding that's his path for you. If you pray to find God's will, then when you pray for his will to become a reality in your life, then he will answer your prayer. Number two is ask for others to pray for you. And that sounds like number one, but it's slightly different. It's an extension of number one, but it deserves its own category because we often ask for someone to pray for us when we have a need or a crisis or a concern and maybe a full-on disaster happening in our life. But as Christians, we're happy to pray for others. It's an integral part of our prayer life. So be prepared to ask, be bold, and ask for others to join you in your own personal prayers, because 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, therefore encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. Also pray together. If someone asks you to pray for them, maybe do it right there. There's nothing like knowing that people care enough to drop everything and take care of it at that moment. How many times have you said, I'll pray for you, and then you realize later that you never did? It happens so easily. We get busy, we get distracted, and our promise to pray goes undone, even when a person really needs that prayer. So what's the solution? Pray now. Instead of, I will pray for you, say, can I pray with you? Now. Matthew 18:20, for where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Done. The power of prayer for or with someone should not be understated. It's critical to our faith and for each of us when we're in times of trouble. It's a boost and strengthens our resolve that God is indeed surrounding us like a fortress. Number three, we come back to it again, read his word. There's a tendency to turn all of our focus to the task in hand when we're in crisis. We can't think about anything else. We don't want to think about anything else because we don't think that anything is important enough to think about other than this. Spending time in the Bible is not wasted time. It is a critical investment in our faith, especially during times when trouble finds us. The Psalms is a great place to be during those long, dark valleys. The Word of God is powerful. Hebrews 4:12, for the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The Bible is the operating handbook of life. And it's not just for when we're feeling good or feeling close to God and when we actually have time to read the Bible. But the wisdom and instruction in this book are tools that we need in despair, the weapon we need in a fight, and the education when we don't know what to do next. Number four is accept that there will be suffering. As I talked about earlier, Paul has been through some exceptionally trying times, a long laundry list of stuff. He has suffered for his faith, and he's accepted it as part of his journey. It did not dissuade him from his journey. A more modern example of the acceptance of suffering is the story of Brother Yun. He was instrumental in developing the Christian house church networks in China in the 80s and 90s. These are the kinds of secret churches that prompted David Platt to put together his annual Bible study called Secret Church. Brother Yun was incarcerated in China and tortured for weeks through electrocution, starvation, beatings, and even had needles inserted under his fingernails. He ended up in a tiny cell, 4 by 3 feet in size. And while there, he prayed for a Bible. Not for the suffering to stop, not for the escape, but he felt at the time that he needed to pray for a Bible. This kind of contraband in this prison was unheard of. Talk about a prayer of the seemingly impossible. But the next day, one of the guards threw a Bible into his cell. And he writes in his autobiography, The Heavenly Man, I knelt down and wept, thanking the Lord for his great gift. I could scarcely believe my dream had come true. No prisoner was ever allowed to have a Bible or any Christian literature. Yet strangely, God provided a Bible for me. Through this incident, the Lord showed me that regardless of men's evil plans for me, he had not forgotten me and he was still in control. He accepted the suffering but knew that God was in control. Not that he wouldn't have asked for relief from the torture, but there was something more driving in people like Paul and Brother Yun. They are focused primarily on being godly, being sinless, and helping other people to be comforted by the fact that God is a protective wing around them. He also knew that it would end. He would either die, and he'd end up in the ultimate place for all mankind with God, or he would be released or escape. He eventually did escape in a story that defies all human logic. But it does demonstrate the power of God. He literally walked out of the prison through doors that should have been locked but weren't, and past guards that just could not see him, even though they were standing right next to him. This account was confirmed by stunned prisoners in the Chinese prison, and the government finally concluded that he received no human help in this escape. What was unwritten was he received spiritual help. Some of the guards lost their jobs because of it. It just seemed unfathomable. So there will be suffering, maybe not to that extreme, but God will be there as our refuge and our stronghold in these times of suffering, and that is the hope. Number five is don't get distracted. We live in a very distracting world. It's amazing how quickly we can be distracted these days. When things are not going well in our lives and we're living in a crisis, it's easy to get distracted with worry, and it's easy to create false urgency to problems. Often issues will take time to work through, time to resolve. And when we have other people involved that don't seem to have the same sense of urgency that we do, it can be frustrating. But we can't be distracted. We need to focus on God. Focus on that which will strengthen us, not weaken us. Worry weakens us. Stress weakens us. Not taking care of our basic needs weakens us, and this can create a spiral which won't help resolve anything. We cannot be distracted by these things. We need to focus on the love of God and surround ourselves with his protection to ride out the storm, unencumbered by those things that distract us and weaken us. It's something we have to learn as Christians, even when we aren't in the low points of our lives. God is still a priority. We must avoid getting distracted away from that. We must have a laser-like focus on him, where we can put Jesus as the focal point or the hub around which everything else in our life revolves. And finally, number six, and this is the hardest because it incorporates everything else. Give up on yourself. Sounds crazy to say, but give up on ourselves. Give it all to God. Don't rely on yourself to know everything and do everything. Give it all to God. There is nothing in your life that God can't do something with. There is nothing in your, there's no area in your life that God shouldn't be involved in, because God gives us life and he gives us everything that we have. And he has a plan for us. In times of trouble, it will feel like God has let go, left us out in the cold with nothing to protect ourselves. But we feel that like that, not because God abandons us, because he won't abandon us. Isaiah 41:10, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you in the righteous right hand. We feel like we've been abandoned because it's us who turns away from God. We turn inwardly what we perceive to be the right solution because we thought of it and it's immediately there in front of us. So no, God doesn't leave us. He doesn't let go of us in times of crisis and need. It's us that turns away from him in our own self-involvement. And we use solutions created apart from God, and then we wonder why they don't have the outcome that we expected. We've heard this expression before, and I'll use it again. We need to be all in. Our faith isn't supposed to be something we pull out when it's convenient to our lives. It's a lifestyle. We need to establish a relationship with God through prayer, through reading his word, through trusting him, even when it seems like things aren't going the way they're supposed to. And that's what creates the refuge, the fortress around our lives. So let me close with this. A man just got married and was returning home with his wife. They were crossing a lake in a boat when suddenly a great storm arose. The man was a warrior, but the woman was very afraid because it seemed almost hopeless. The boat was small, the storm was very powerful, and at any moment they were going to be drowned. But the man sat silently and calm as if nothing was happening. The woman was trembling and she said, "Are you not afraid? These might be the last moments of our life. It doesn't seem like we'll be able to reach the other side of the lake. Only some miracle can save us now. Otherwise, death is certain. How are you not afraid? Have you lost your mind? Are you not? Do you have no emotion? What is it?" The man laughed and took out his sword from his sheath. The woman was even more puzzled. What's he doing now? Then he brought the sharp sword close to her neck, so close that the smallest gap was there, and it was almost touching her skin. He said to her, "Are you afraid?" And now she started to laugh. She said, "Why would I be afraid? As long as the sword is in your hands, I know I'm safe. I know you wouldn't harm me because you love me." So he put the sword back and sat back in the boat. He smiled and said, "That is my answer to you. I know God loves me, and he has a storm in his hands." So we'll find dark valleys, and we'll find times of hardship, stress, and of despair. But God is still in control. He'll be there for us as our refuge, our happy place, our home. We just need to make sure that we don't turn away from him, because he won't turn away from us. Romans 8:38 and 39. "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, and that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Let us pray. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us if we don't trust in you. Forgive us if we're not putting all our hope in you in times of crisis. But we thank you for your availability. We thank you for being the refuge and the fortress. We pray that we will turn to you in times of need and we will not turn away and then blame you for our turning away. If we've never tried this before, I pray that we will try this. We will see a big difference in our lives, and we will see our lives transformed by the love that you provide us. You wrap a wing of protection around us when we most need it, but even when we don't necessarily need it. And for this, we love you. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.